the international relations as a topic fine to mention in its prelims as well as mains exam. In prelims, it is just a small topic mentioned as current topics of national and international importance. So anything that is of national or international importance, it is one second. I'm sorry. Board is not working. Stylus is not working. Just a second. Yeah, it's okay. Thank you. So current events of national and international importance. So a lot of events which are of international importance, from a prelims perspective, it is important to know them. Now, in prelims, the international relations can be asked directly in the form of international relations, because you could easily find, hey, this is an IR-related question. Sometimes, it is not so apparent that it is an IR-related question. It could be camouflaged as a geography question. Okay? It could be camouflaged as a geography question. So, if something happens in South China Sea, maybe the question was about an island, and the island is in South China Sea, and you were not aware of it. Possibly. Yeah? So something was asked, related to Ukraine geographically. Yeah, but the reason was not geography. The reason was the continued conflict between Russia and United States over the potential inclusion of Ukraine into NATO. There can be multiple cases in which it looks like a geography question, but the basis can be traced to international relations. Okay, so that's on the prelims part. Now let's come to the mains part. So in mains, international relations, as you all are aware, it is part of our general studies too. Yeah, so you have a major section on polity, social justice, governance, etc. And on an average, I just looked at the last 3 to 4 years, the marks for international relations is varying between 45 to 65. I think in 1 year it was 70. So 70 is the maximum that they have asked. 45 is the minimum that they have asked. So you can roughly say 50 to 60 marks I can definitely get in IR if I were to study the IR well. Yeah, if I were to study the IR well. Okay. Now let's look at what does the mains syllabus tell us about international relations, and how is international relations structured. So our approach will be attuned to the structure. So let's go with the structure one by one. First is India and its neighborhood relations. So it's basically say India and its neighborhood. So when I say India and its neighborhood, it includes all the countries with whom India shares a boundary. Sometimes may not share a boundary, but may be very close maritime wise. Yeah, for example, Maldives, Sri Lanka. So they will also be included. So the countries that I cover, that I will cover under India and its neighborhood relations are, we'll start with Pakistan, then we go China. Then if we are looking in the north, what are the other countries that we have? We have Nepal, we have Bhutan, we have Bangladesh, we have, coming to the east now, we have Myanmar, then south, we have Sri Lanka, we have Maldives. So how many countries is over? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, right? And then we also will cover Afghanistan, even though Afghanistan is more of a Central Asian republic, so to say, and it does not share a boundary with India. Are you aware that Afghanistan does not share a boundary with India? It does not. Yeah, especially because of the POK thing, because of the Pak-occupied Kashmir. Afghanistan would have shared a boundary with us had we had the full of JNK. Okay, but since a large part is now Pak-occupied Kashmir, Afghanistan is not our neighbor. So we've touched all the parts that, so these are the countries that I will share, I will progress one by one. And of this, around 40% of our emphasis will be on this gentleman, China. Okay, China. Now, okay, so that's on the first part, India and its neighborhood relations. So these are all the countries that we'll discuss. The second part says bilateral, regional and global groupings and agreements involving India and or affecting India. So they are telling of two types, agreements that directly involves India or agreements that affects India's interest. Okay. Now, is there any bilateral agreement that you can, you know, immediately remember? Any bilateral agreement of India? Can someone tell me any bilateral agreement that you can think of? Bilateral means what? Between how many countries? Two countries. So it is going to be India vis-a-vis some other country. Any bilateral agreement or understanding? Excellent. Great. Both of them are right answers. Panchshil as a concept, open skies. Very good. Very good, Prachin. Bhavna, that's also right. Indus Water Treaty. How about your Shimla Agreement with Pakistan? Yeah. We have something like river water agreements with Bangladesh. Yeah, we have so many agreements. We have maybe a bilateral trade pact. We may have something like 2+2 agreement with whom? United States. Yeah, that's not an agreement. That's more of an understanding. So good. So you guys are clear. So that is an example of bilateral groupings or agreement. Now regional groupings. Regional groupings or agreement that has India. Any example? Regional groupings that has India. SAR, exactly. SAR is the most important of all. Then BIMSTEC, very good. SAR, BIMSTEC. How about ASEAN plus 6? Exactly. That's right, Shafi. ASEAN per se does not include India, but they expanded it to make it ASEAN plus 6, and in that we are part of that. Shanghai, excellent point, Vishanji. Shanghai Cooperation Organization. With China, Pakistan, Kazakhstan, and some of the Central Asian, Russia, some of the Central Asian republics. Great. So this is an example of regional grouping. Very good, guys. Very good. And in all of this, India is a part. Shanghai, it's a part. ASEAN plus 6, it's a part. SAARC, it's a part. BIMSTEC, it's a part. So on and so forth. Okay. Now, sometimes there may be groupings. Okay. Now, let's come to the global grouping. Any global grouping that India is a part of? Quad is also Quad. Yeah, you can say Quad is global. You are right. You are right, because it's spread all over the place. Countries from different places. G20. How about the most important of all global grouping or organization? Yeah, United Nations. Absolutely, United Nations. How about WTO? How about WTO? How about accepting to be part of United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change? So any grouping related to environment, related to trade at a global level, IMF, World Bank, absolutely, Harsh. IMF, World Bank, all of this. Yeah, so good. We got a good understanding of the difference between a bilateral grouping, regional grouping, global grouping, involving India and or affecting interests. Now, I want to ask you, one subtle point here. You know, the syllabus, if you look at it, it has two parts. Bilateral, regional, global grouping. A, involving India. B, affecting India's interest. Now, can you think of a bilateral grouping or agreement in which India is not a part, but can affect India's interest? A bilateral grouping. Yeah, BRI, you could say that, but it is kind of driven by one country. CPEC, excellent, excellent. I was expecting that answer, CPEC. So BRI, Prachi, you are right. That part of BRI which deals with Pakistan. So Pakistan-China Economic Corridor is a bilateral agreement between China and Pakistan, but which directly impacts India. Superb. That's good. Now, similarly, is there any global grouping that you can think about of which India is not a part, but it can or it is affecting India's interest? Awesome. That's great, Prachi. NSG. I did not expect people to answer so fast, but good. NSG is an excellent example. 48 member countries, India has been trying to become a part of NSG because that we know the advantages of joining the nuclear supply group, but for various reasons, China being one important reason, we have not been able to be part of this global grouping. Yeah. With the same logic, I may say, how would UNSC? UNSC is one part, United Nations Security Council. India is not a part, but as a group, they meet, and sometimes very recently, I don't know whether you're aware, in 2019, when India abrogated Article 370 for JNK, UNSC had a special session. So now that comes under this category, a global grouping that affects India's interest. Yeah. Now, regional grouping. So there may be some regional groupings that may also impact India. Any idea? Regional grouping. AUKUS, yeah, AUKUS can in a roundabout way, but it can. I give you that, AUKUS. RCEP, excellent. I think all of you are firing in all cylinders. RCEP, India consciously decided not to enter. Anything on the west of India? So good. Both the examples that Yogesh and Shaundi have given is to the right of India, that is to the east of India. Any grouping to the west of India? How about OPEC? OPEC, How about OIC, Organization of Islamic Conference? You have heard. Yeah, Pakistan tries to raise the Kashmir issue there, and sometimes, so India does not come under pressure, but sometimes that adds up a little bit of a pressure on us. Okay, good guys. I think point B is absolutely clear. Point A, anyway, there wasn't much to explain. Now let's come to point C. Effect of policies and politics of developed and developing countries on India's interest. Effect of policies and politics of, okay, now let's take one point. Policies and politics of developed country that can affect India's interest. And you can give me examples either way, positive or negative. USA, excellent. H-1B visa, good. So that is an example of the policy of a developed country impacting India directly. Because when Trump was there, they put a limit on the H-1B visa. Now with the Democratic Party coming in, we may expect some relaxation, but it is still not sure. Good guys. So developed country. Similarly, if you look at Brexit, Britain exiting from EU, that has both positive impact and negative impact on India, which we will discuss when we talk about India and European Union. Effect and policies of developing country. Yeah, visa on Covaxin, that's also right, Harsh. Covaxin was not accepted, or still is perhaps not accepted for many countries when you have to travel outside, have to take international travel. Developing countries and interest. Okay, JPCON ties with Iran. Okay, that is an example, Abhishek, of developed country, because US, EU, and Iran together have got into this agreement with Iran for preventing its nuclear proliferation. So that is your right. So to that extent, it is a policy of developed country like US and EU, and their impact on Iran and how it impacts India. That's very good. GSP, okay. Sri Lanka, China puts, okay, good. You could say that effect or policies of China, I think we can for all practical purpose call it as developed, because it is really aspiring with US for the world power position. So that's an example. So how about Pakistan's policy vis-a-vis Afghanistan? Yeah, that's a good example of policy of a developing country like Pakistan. Yeah, and its impact on India. Okay, so Prachi, in your case, you are saying Sri Lanka. Yeah, Sri Lanka is a developing country accepting Chinese investment and causing a little unease in India. How about Nepal, the Communist Party in Nepal getting too cozy with the Communist Party in China and causing a little bit of a problem for India? So there are multiple examples. Good. Now, the reason why I'm taking so much time for each and every point is next time when you see a newspaper article, you should mentally put a matrix in your head and you should know, oh, this news article fits into this part of the IR syllabus. Okay, that is the only purpose why we are taking so much time in trying to understand the syllabus and which topic would come under which heading. Great, guys. The last is important international institutions. Okay, agencies, fora, structure. Okay, so it could be WTO, World Bank. It could be BRICS Bank, for example. That's also an important international institute. New Development Bank, part of BRICS. So BRICS, someone said BRICS. I someone just mentioning that person's point. So BRICS would also easily come in one of these things. You could call BRICS, because it is South Africa, India, China, Russia. Yeah, it is global grouping, I would say. It's no more regional because it is spread over three different continents, Asia, Africa, and South America. Yeah, so BRICS is also a global grouping. Important international institutions, sometimes they ask these questions on UN, UNESCO, WTO, WHO. All of them are important. They are relatively static topics. So of all the three, D is relatively static. The first three are completely dynamic. Yeah, suppose you've been preparing for 4 years, let's say. Unfortunately, IR is relentless in that case. What you prepared 3 years back could have been used for history, for geography, for polity, for economy to a good extent, because the base is the same. But for IR, to that extent, it's relentless. If it is more than 3 years old, most probably you may have to do substantial updation. Okay. What are the books, reference material that you need for preparing effectively for IR, be it for 2022 or 2023? As I said, yes. I'm sorry. Just in the case of environment, I am taking care that I take information from multiple sources, collate it in a way, hopefully put it in the form of a story form so that you are able to remember it better. That story will be supplemented by good amount of printed notes, which is your slides. That should be good enough. An additional source of reference could be Hindu newspaper, which gives more than proportional response for proportional space for international relations news, and Indian Express is also good. So one of these two you can read. Should I go and read ORF, no, Observer Research Foundation article? Not necessary. At least for general studies, not necessary. If you are an PSIR optional student, I might have still suggested that. Should I read this IDSA article, sir? Should I read this Diplomat, magazine? All that will be little over the top. Between my notes and Hindu newspaper should give you sufficient conceptual framework and current affairs. Okay, so both I am trying to do. What I am trying to do for all the countries is I am trying to have some historical basis, especially for the neighboring countries, and I am trying to give the last approximately 2 years of current affairs, so that gives you a lot of confidence to face the examination. Okay, great. So yeah, now is there any specific book that I have to study? So there are two books. So one book is India. I even forgot the name of the book, but the author is Rajiv Sikri. Yeah, there is another book called Pax Indica by Shashi Tharoor. Rajiv Sikri is an ex-Indian diplomat, and this was Indian Foreign Policy Challenges and Strategy, something of those type. And the second book is Pax Indica. Okay, so do not buy either of these books. Yeah, you don't have to buy either of this book. But you may say, why did you ask us to write it? I mean, this is basically to tell, because the question keeps coming, do we have to read? Why I don't recommend Rajiv Sikri is for the simple reason that the last version of Rajiv Sikri is 2009 or 10. Yeah, and in 10 years, a lot of things changes in IR. The entire policy changes. We've come to NAM 2. Links to good articles, I'll do that. The way I have been doing for environment, wherever there is a Hindu editorial or an Indian Express editorial, that much I can do. So Rajiv Sikri and Pax Indica, Shashi Tharoor, it is, you will read everything and then you will think, "Arey, where should I apply?" That is, I have read that book more than 50%. It's something that you can, browse through during your bed, just before your bedtime, but you can't base your preparation on any of these books. Okay, great. So let's move on. So we just saw the syllabus, right? We just saw, I told you this ABC. Okay. So this is one way of looking at the syllabus. The other way of looking at the syllabus is like this. See the map over here? The first circle. What does the first circle represent? The first circle represents India and its neighbors. So you can see Pakistan, China, Nepal, all of them getting covered, more or less. The second, what should I say, ellipse, yeah, if not circle, where what am I doing? I'm going a little towards my west, I'm going a little towards the north, and I'm going a little towards the east. This circle I call as India and its extended neighborhood. So the first circle is India and its neighbors, which is those nine countries that I mentioned in the previous slide. The second ellipse is India and its extended neighborhood. So extended neighborhood, may what is it that we are seeing? We are seeing West Asia. Again, we will not cover West Asia in totality because it's a separate chapter or it's a separate book in itself. We will discuss key points: India, Israel, India, Saudi Arabia, India, Iran, and how is the dynamics between these two? How does India manage to kind of play a delicate balancing role of being friends with Israel, so much so that we are their largest defense partner on one hand, while at the same time not hurting the sentiments of Palestinians? Because India has been traditionally with the Palestine when it comes to voting on the Palestinian issue. How does India walk this delicate balance of a Shia majority country like Iran and a Sunni majority country like Saudi Arabia, where both those countries themselves are sworn enemies, but we need to do business with both of them? Saudi Arabia has one of the largest Indian diaspora. Maximum, a lot of people across sectors, a lot of them are in construction sectors, but across sectors, a lot of Indians are in Saudi Arabia, and so in other countries, Abu Dhabi, Qatar, Bahrain, and what else? Am I missing something? Jordan and all, not that much. But these three, four countries, a lot of Indian diaspora there. And therefore, we are dependent on what is called as Gulf remittances. You must have heard of this in economics. So there is a very strong link both from a diaspora point of view and from an economics point of view. So you can't afford to just, you know, doesn't matter whatever is happening in Gulf and least bother. So it's a very, very delicate balance role. Israel-Palestine, you know, how do we balance? Iran and Saudi Arabia, how do we balance? Rest of the region, how do we balance? Okay, that's point number one. So that is your extended neighborhoods, let's say A. The extended neighborhood B. What is extended neighborhood B? In this, what you have is a lot of central Commonwealth of Independent States are also called as the Central Asian countries, which are the erstwhile, which are part of erstwhile USSR. Yeah, as you may be aware, when USSR disintegrated, it created a lot of stans. Yeah, STANs, Kazakhstan, Kyrgyzstan, Uzbekistan, Tajikistan, all the stans in the world. Now, Central Asia has its own strategic importance, A, from an energy perspective, B, also from a potential transportation corridor perspective, which we will discuss. So Central Asian country becomes very important. So Indian neighbor, and to the north you go, it is Afghanistan and some of these other stans. To the west you go, you have the entire West Asia or the Middle East. Acha, my Middle East, I forgot to tell you the other thing. I talked about Indian diaspora and the economy part, Gulf remittances part. What is also very important is powering India's energy needs. A lot of oil gets imported from there. Yeah, that is the third part when it comes to Gulf. Then comes the Southeast Asia part. Technically, they don't share a boundary with India. Vietnam, for example. Here, map is not very great, but Singapore and Malaysia. Thailand, Cambodia, not so much, but Vietnam, Singapore, Malaysia, Thailand, Indonesia, Philippines. Philippines, and let's not forget our Japan and South Korea also. We have South Korea. So Japan, South Korea, Vietnam, Singapore, Malaysia, each one has its own importance. Japan, what is our importance? Vietnam, what is our importance? Japan, the simple importance is Japan and India share a common enemy, which is China. Yeah. So to that extent, India-Japan relationship is very similar to China-Pakistan relationship. The only reason why China is so-called an all-weather friend of Pakistan. Yeah, do you understand all-weather friend? The meaning of all-weather friend means rain or shine, we will be friends. Yeah, if you can think of the Sholay movie, Amitabh Bachchan and Dharmendra. Yeah, so they are an example of all-weather friend. One will die for the other, but in diplomacy, no one dies for the other. Okay, that's the only difference. So you have Japan, South Korea. So Japan and South Korea, not just are we strategically integrated, we are also economically very well integrated. South Korea has a major, has done a lot of investment in India. Japan has done a lot of investment in India. For example, Chennai Metro, which I've been using for several years now, that is funded by Japan. JICO is the funding agency. Vietnam. Now, why is Vietnam important? Vietnam is important because of the energy needs. India and Vietnam have done a lot of energy deals together. And it is not a coincidence that Vietnam is also a part of the South China Sea boundary dispute with China. Okay, Thailand. Thailand is also important because India plans to reach, which we will discuss when we talk about Look East policy. So all these countries have become important, especially because of what is called as India's Look East policy. Look East policy, which was championed by our late Prime Minister P.V. Narasimha Rao. Look East. Act East is an upgradation of it. Not much has changed, but predominantly Look East is the base on which India started looking towards the East. Rather than looking towards the West, it started looking towards the East and kind of tried to gain the best out of them, both from an economic point of view and from strategic point of view. Economic point of view, I've told, Japan is economically important. South Korea has invested in a lot of initiatives in India. Vietnam, we are having energy thing. But Thailand, Singapore, Malaysia, here India is strengthening its base. Myanmar also would come under Look East policy. Even though it's a neighbor, it comes under Look East policy because we want to prevent the Chinese ingress into this part of Asia. Okay, we want to just keep the Chinese away by making our presence spread. Okay, so that completes two circles. India and its neighbors is the small circle. India and its extended neighbor is the second circle. So this is the second circle. Then comes your third circle. Third circle is what? Third circle is India and the world. So pretty much everything. Obviously, world means we will not be talking about India's relationship with every country. We'll be talking of India's relationship with the superpowers. And that too purely from current affairs. So please remember, the historical context that I'll be teaching you is limited only for India and its neighbors. Because we have a shared history, no? That, and a shared geography also. It's called the Indian subcontinent. When we go to 2, the historical dimension will come down. When we go to 3, it will be completely current affairs. Are you able to understand it? So this will be historical plus current affairs. This will be current affairs plus some amount of history. This will be out and out current affairs. So in this, what are all the major countries? So EU. Yeah, EU. Then I'll talk about US. Then I'll talk about Russia. Japan, I have covered in the extended name. Yeah, Australia, not very eventful thing is happening. Australia is there. I mean, we are one of the, you know, the education sector. India gives a lot of business to Australia because many of the Indians go and study in Australia. So New Zealand also, we have some Indian diaspora there also. Okay, so are we clear on it? So this is the second way to look at the syllabus of three concentric, not necessarily concentric circles, but three ellipses or three circles. India and its neighborhood, India and its extended neighborhood, and India and the world. That parts three parts, that forms three parts. The fourth one is international organizations.